how much, when it comes to devolution, how much of those powers can be accorded to devolved territories without precisely rocking the boat mm-hmm. of the central government?
Well, in Scotland, we had power over our budget for the areas that were our responsibilities. We had power over education, over health, the environment, criminal law, civil law, a whole local government, a whole bundle of different areas. And
banking also, yeah.
Although main banking regulations were still the responsibility of the UK.
Mm-hmm.
So there will be some areas that are still the legislative responsibility of the UK, other areas that were devolved to Scotland. And it's very similar to this arrangement here for the Bangsamoro. And it's in practice that arrangement has worked because there are certain economic and security powers that the state as a whole mm-hmm. has an interest in, and it makes sense for the state as a whole to be responsible for. But other areas like education and health and local government, transport, environment, these are areas that are far better decided at the local level, where people are really connected to their autonomous parliament. And that's worked for us in Scotland, and I'm sure it would work for the Bangsamoro.
And they will be in the best position to precisely define their needs when it comes to those issues. But which prerogatives can't and should not be devolved, do you think?
Well, ultimately, that's for the Filipino people mm-hmm. to decide, and for the legislators here in the Philippines to decide, and not for me to tell them. But in the UK, the way it works is that areas of foreign policy, of security, and of overall economic policy and regulation, they are all retained by the central government and the Parliament of the United Kingdom. And other areas of domestic policy are devolved to the Scottish Parliament, and to some extent in Northern Ireland and Wales as well. So it's quite a good separation here between what are clearly the responsibilities of the wider state: economic policy, security, foreign affairs, whereas in areas where we have a domestic interest that might well be different from another part of the country, different conditions, different history, different identity. In these areas, we can make our own decisions, and we have done very well.
Did you glean some of these points from your conversations with the stakeholders in Cotabato, and what were those points?
Well, the key thing about that part of Mindanao, and the islands as well, is that this is the most underdeveloped part of the Philippines. The Philippines is a growing economy. It's growing in stature internationally. It has a real potential to be one of the big economic, maybe even political powers in the world in this century. But in this part of the Philippines, there is a level of underdevelopment, of illiteracy and backward development that is holding back the rest of the country, as well as those who live there. And I think that's the key issue here, is what is the best way to develop that part of the country and make sure the whole of the Philippines is moving forward in this century. And the best way to do that is to give people the power and the responsibility to make their own decisions. They'll get it wrong sometimes, they'll get it right sometimes, but if you have your own power and your own responsibility, then you take that future into your own hands and you make something of it. And that's been the experience all over the world with devolved governments. I'm sure it'll be the experience here with the Bangsamoro as well.
But in the case of Scotland and Northern Ireland, mm-hmm. what has made it work? You're saying for over a decade in the
yep.
case of Ireland, it's been proof
yep.
that it works.
Well, let me give you an example in Northern Ireland, where they had had a terrible conflict for decades. Since they had the Assembly elected back after the peace agreement in 1998-99, Northern Ireland not only has become peaceful, but it's become the fastest developing part of the mm-hmm. United Kingdom. Mm-hmm. So the politicians and the business leaders and the other civic leaders of that part of the country have worked together to attract inward investment, to come up with development plans, to improve the education system, to get young people committed to that area and stop moving out the area, which is what was happening before. And in Scotland, let me give you one example from Scotland. We had a historic problem of depopulation, where more people moved out of Scotland than moved into Scotland. People were attracted by the bright lights of London, in the same way as people here are attracted by the bright lights of Manila.
Mm-hmm.
And when devolution happened in 1999, and when I became First Minister in 2001, one of the key priorities that I set was to reverse that depopulation. And Scotland's population has increased every single year since 2004. So we are now on an increasing population trajectory that we were never on before. And that is because as a country, we've become more cohesive. We've been identifying the things that need to be solved in Scotland and then taking the action to solve them. and making Scotland a much more attractive place for young people to stay and also to come back to. And if that could be achieved in the Bangsamoro area of Mindanao and the islands, that would be a fantastic achievement for the Philippines at this point in the 21st century.
A lot of optimism coming from you. Certainly, we would hope to see it work here. But how do you think can BBL work, considering the issues that have been raised, the challenges lawmakers are up against? There have been, again, a question of trust, the powers, the division. What do you think still needs to be done, or might Congress have to address at this point?
Well, obviously, there have been a lot of debates about the language in the law and some of the individual provisions, and the lawmakers need to resolve those debates, both in the House and in the Senate, over these few months. They then need to get the transition right. If they pass the basic law and agree to create the Bangsamoro Autonomous Parliament, then the transition has to be right. There has to be an engagement with the regional government of the area, and bringing the MILF and others into that process. I think one of the important things that will be different about this new parliament in the Bangsamoro area is that the parliament itself will include not just those who represent Muslim Mindanao, but they will be those from the local Catholic population, the indigenous peoples. All of these people will all be represented in the parliament, and they will have to be part of the solution, they have to be part of the discussion. And I think that will be it will be really interesting, because at the moment the perception in the Philippines as well as elsewhere is this is an area that's really just got one population, but it's got a variety of populations.
But what might be missing in the equation, you think?
What might be missing? I think there's still an issue of trust with some of the lawmakers. Some people remain to be convinced that they should make this big decision at this point in the history of the Philippines. I think a lot of the detail has been very well worked out, very well discussed. Some of the language needs to be resolved and tweaked over these debates. But I really do hope that those who have been most involved, and I've met with Congressman Rodriguez on a number of occasions, for example, on his committee, those who have been most involved in this really believe in this process. They've not walked in off the street and somebody's come up with a smart idea and they suddenly run with it. They've been deeply involved. They've been convinced of the genuine commitment of everybody to peace, and they have looked at international examples, and they're trying to make this work. And I hope the rest of the lawmakers will trust their judgment and back them in this approach.
But the public also still has to be convinced. I think they're divided when it comes to that as well.
And that's understandable.
More so, yes. Lord McConnell, because the issue of having to change the charter to accommodate all these issues has been brought up.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think I can understand why the general public of the Philippines is nervous about this change. You know, when you've had a conflict like this in recent decades, that creates fears and uncertainties and so on. Sometimes it's the responsibility of the politicians to show leadership and to convince the country. While as a politician you want to reflect public opinion, you can also lead public opinion as well. And I think there's an opportunity here for lawmakers in the Philippines to lead public opinion. If we had gone solely with public opinion in Northern Ireland, in the UK back in 1998, the peace process would have been scrapped after the Omagh bombing. But Tony Blair and the other lawmakers, and to some extent the leaders of the different armed groups as well in Northern Ireland, chose a leadership for peace. And they chose to lead public opinion rather than just reflect it. And today, young people leaving school in Northern Ireland have spent their whole lives in a peaceful environment. That was a prize that was definitely worth fighting for.
And you believe that when it comes to the BBL, just like the president and other voices have said, that this is time, and the BBL is certainly time to give peace a chance.
Well, I can't remember another similar area anywhere in the world that I've gone to visit where the National Army, people on the ground, the regional government that's going to lose power to this new body, the local stakeholders and so on, the armed group and the national politicians are all committed to a peaceful solution that creates a democratic, autonomous parliament. And so committed to it, they're willing to work together to make it happen. I think this is a moment in the history of the Philippines, a moment in time that the lawmakers should seize over these coming months and make this happen.
Well, the